Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.
And welcome to Homework Hotline. I'm Joe Zuniga.
Hi, and I'm Ed Hathaway. Homework Hotline is the place where you can get help with your homework on the phone, online, or on TV.
Now, here's how the show works. There's teachers and Dial Teacher stand by right now to take your call and help you with your homework.
Now, if you'd like help with your homework, call Dial Teacher free at 888-986-2345.
Now, you can also send us your comments on our new website at homeworkhotline.org. Just click on the Yak Back button and send in your comments.
All right, now we'll get to our first question in a minute. But it's Thursday. That means it's time for Mr. Z's Science Challenge. What do you got, Mr. Z?
All right. Well, you know, I'm not going to give away too much information here.
All right.
For some of our high school students, I think they'll know what this is. So what I have here, I'll hold it up so they can see. So we have a thermometer here. Okay. No, it's just a regular thermometer. It's a Celsius thermometer. Okay.
Okay.
But on the back side is another thermometer. And this one has a little piece of cotton over the end of the bulb.
Gotcha.
Okay. And they're just attached to the stick that I could swing them around if I so choose.
You so choose, okay.
All right. And so our question is, what is this instrument and what is it used for? What does it help us do in science?
All right, now I couldn't answer that question. I tried to get it right, but again, the science challenge for today is, what is the item Mr. Z is holding? What is it used for? Now, if you think you can solve that science challenge, give our hotline a call at 1-866-264-5904. Or you can just answer our website, homeworkhotline.org. Answer correctly, and you could have a chance to share the answer at the end of the show.
Now, every correct response will be added to our Hotline Hall of Fame. If you earn enough points, you get a tablet at the end of the season.
Tablets.
And maybe if we have some time, we'll actually do it and see what it does.
I would love to do that.
All right.
I'll learn more. I'm always up for that.
Now, should we do some homework?
Let's do some knowledge.
All right.
Hello.
Hi, it's Alyssa.
Hi.
Hi, Alyssa. How are you?
Good.
How are you today? You're doing well?
Yeah.
Good.
All right. So you got a math question for us, Alyssa?
Yes.
All right. I'll take this one, Mr. Z. Go ahead, Alyssa. What's your math question?
5 1/5 times 8 5/6.
Okay. So it's a multiplication of fractions.
Yes.
We got 5 1/5 times, what was the other mixed number?
8 5/6.
8 5/6. Okay. Okay. Now, Alyssa, I mentioned the term mixed number. What does that mean? What does a mixed number mean? Do you know?
It's a whole number and a fraction.
Very good. We do have a whole number and a fraction. Eventually, we're going to change this problem so that they're not a mixed number. It's going to be improper for a little while. Isn't that right?
Yes.
Okay. Why don't you get us started then, since you know about improper fractions? How would you get this problem started?
You would multiply the whole numbers.
Okay. Well, you could. You mean you multiply 5 times 8?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I wasn't going to do it that way, but you're going to multiply 5 times 8 and get 40? Then what would you do?
Then you would multiply the fractions.
Okay, and then you got the whole number and the fractions. What do you do with those?
I think you would maybe turn it into a number with the fraction out of 100.
All right, I understand that. But I want to get into a little bit with the improper fractions, okay? Remember we mentioned that?
Yeah.
And your way wouldn't quite get us there. So let's go through with this little improper fraction. I hope this doesn't upset the way you wanted to do this, but I think you'll probably have seen this before. Okay, Alyssa?
Okay.
All right, Alyssa, help me out. What's 5 times 5?
5 times 5 is 25.
Plus the one up there, the numerator?
That would be 26.
Okay, have you seen this before, Alyssa?
We've tried it in class, but we haven't really done it before.
Okay, let's go through this one with our audience today. All right, so we got 26 over 5. That's an improper fraction. We'll get into that again in a minute. Can you help me change 8 5/6, Alyssa? Alyssa, what's 6 times 8?
6 times 8 is 48.
Well, what's 48 plus 5?
48 plus 5 would be 53.
Very good. Very good. Now, I got 26 over 5 times 53 over 6. Why are those two fractions considered improper?
Because it's a larger number over a smaller number.
You know more than you think. You're doing great here, Alyssa. Okay, so I'm going to go even further with you on this. What we could do is multiply all the numerators, all the denominators, divide, and we will get into that. But we can actually do a little bit of canceling out here. I can see the 26 and the 6. Well, they have a common multiple, or they have a common factor there. We have a number that goes into both of them evenly. Do you know what number goes into 26 and 6 evenly?
24?
Well, that's a little bit too big for the 6, isn't it? I'm thinking of a number that's less than 6. How about 2? How many times will 2 go into 6?
Yeah.
How many times will 2 go into 6?
3.
3. And how many times will 2 go into 26?
2 would go into 26 11 times.
I'm going to say 13 times. 13 times 2 is 26. How's that, Alyssa, huh?
Uh-huh.
Okay, now we still got some kind of large numbers, but it's a little bit less. All right, now we're going to multiply. Well, let's do the easy ones first, Alyssa. What's 5 times 3?
5 times 3 is 15.
Okay, how are you with your multiplication facts?
I'm pretty good.
All right, I think you are too. I'm going to multiply 53 times 13 with you. Help me out, Alyssa. What's 3 times 3?
3 times 3 is 9.
What's 3 times 5?
3 times 5 is 15.
All right. Put a 0 down. And, of course, 1's easy. What's 1 times 53?
53.
All right. When we add, we'll get 9, 8, and 6. 689 over 15. Okay. Still improper, isn't it, Alyssa?
Yeah.
689 over 15. How can we change that to a mixed number?
Maybe we could... see how many times 15 goes into that number?
Yeah, yeah, you're doing great here, Alyssa. So let's do some more scrap work. Alyssa, does your teacher ever let you use a calculator to do this stuff?
No.
Okay, then we won't. I know, and I was ready to take the easy way out, but we won't. Okay, 15 won't go into 6. Do you have any idea how many times 15 will go into 68?
It'll go in there 4 times.
Well, that's good. That's good, which is 60. When we subtract, we get an 8. Bring down the 9. How many times do you think 15 will go into 89?
I think 15, it may go in there, let's see, maybe 5 times?
You're right. Just shy of a 6 time, but that's 75, and we'd get a remainder of 14. So... we're almost done. We just got to write our answer down. Our quotient was 45. That's our whole number. Okay. Mm-hmm. Our denominator is still 15. What's going to go in the numerator, Alyssa? Do you know?
Would it be 45?
Well, we already got that as our whole number. It's going to be the remainder. So the remainder was 14.
Oh, yeah, 14.
So there's the answer you wanted. That was kind of a tough question, but you knew your math facts. You did very well, Alyssa. Thank you for calling.
Thank you.
Yep, bye-bye. I
said, hey, hey. My very excellent mother just served us noodles. This mnemonic device, or memory tool, can help you remember the order of our planets in our solar system. Mercury, Venus, Earth, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune.
Okay, we're going to do another math question, I think.
Let's do it.
Hello, Juan Pablo, are you there? Hello? Hello? You know, we may have messed him, but I'm going to go to the board.
I'll read
the question, and we'll work it out anyway. Hopefully he's still watching.
I hope Juan is watching. Here it is, Mr. Z. It says, okay. Daniel is going to the park, and the park is in the shape of a rectangle.
All right.
The length of the park is 25 yards, and the width of the park is 15 yards.
All right.
What is the area?
Okay. All right. Now, if we're looking at this, the area, we're talking about all this in here. Okay, now you're probably learning areas and perimeters at the same time. Perimeter would be the distance all the way around, but there's a formula we use for area. And the area is equal to the length times the width, okay? So they gave us the length and width of this park. It was 25 and 15, okay? So let's go to the side here and do our multiplication. We have 25 times 15. So 5 times 5 will be 25. I'll put down my 5. I'll carry my 2. 2 times 5 is 10. Plus 2 is 125. Are you there now, Juan? Hello? Hi, how are you? Okay. Do I have your problem correct that you need to find the area of this rectangle?
Yes.
Okay, and it's 15 by 25 yards?
Yes.
Okay, good. Let's look at what we've looked at so far. Are you familiar with this formula? Area is equal to length times the width?
Yes.
Yes. All right. And would it matter what we call the length, what we call the width? Okay, listen to me on the phone. I think and turn your TV down a little bit. I think you're getting confused because there's a bit of a delay there, okay?
Okay.
All right. But we have 15 and 25 as our two dimensions, right?
Yes.
Yes. So we need to multiply those together, don't we?
Yes.
Okay, and I started that over here. I said 25 times 15, and I started multiplying by the 5. So we said 5 times 5 was 25, but put down a 5. I carried a 2, right? And 2 times 5 was 10, and then I added the 2 in and got 12, okay? So now we're all caught up. Tell me what I'm going to do next. Now we have to multiply by that 1, don't we?
Yes.
But that 1 isn't a 1. It's actually in the tens place, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah. So what do I got to add to hold my place there?
Okay.
So I need to add a 0, right? Since that's actually in the tens place. We're actually not multiplying by 1, but by 10, aren't we?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. 1 times 5 is what?
What?
1 times 5 would be?
5.
5. 1 times 2 is?
1 times 2 is 2.
Good. Now, we always want to check when we get to this point. This number needs to be bigger than our first number. We made a mistake. And usually the mistake you would have made is you forgot to put that 0 in to hold your place. Okay? So it's always a good check at this place to make sure it's bigger. Okay? Uh-huh. Now, what's our next step? What do we have to do next?
Now, we have to add them up.
We do. We got to add them up. So 5 plus 0 is?
So
would be 5, right?
Yes.
What's 2 plus 5?
7.
Good. And 1 plus 2 is?
3.
3. All right, so now let's go back here because this is very important. We want to make sure we have the right units, okay? 375 is half the answer. That's just a number. We need to know what that 375 of, right? So what was our original measurement in? What kind of units? 15 and 25 were both in yards, right?
Yes.
Right. So it's going to be 375 yards, but this is a little bit different because we multiply yards times yards, right?
Yes.
All right. So do you express it as yards squared with a little 2 up there, or do you call them square yards? What have you been doing in class?
Yes.
Hmm?
Mm-hmm.
Which one have you been doing? Have you been doing this way? Because you could also say 375, and sometimes we abbreviate square with the SQ yards. Either one would be appropriate. But it's got to make sure we put the units on it, okay?
Uh-huh.
All right. Sorry we missed you at the beginning of the problem, but you did a great job once we got together. Thanks for calling, Juan Pablo.
I said, hey, hey.
Looking for an easy way to remember all 5 great lakes? Just think of homes. Huron, Ontario, Michigan, Erie, Superior.
All right, now we'll get back to the questions in just a moment. But first, let's take a look at this week's Hotline Book Reviews. Check them out.
This is my book report on Percy Jackson and the Sea of Monsters. Percy, the son of Poseidon, is having bad nightmares of his best friend Grover, who is a satyr. In the dreams, Grover is trapped by a cyclops. The cyclops thinks Grover is his wife, and Grover asks Percy for help. When Percy gets to school, he sees his friend Tyson. Tyson has no parents and lives in the streets in a box. Percy notices 3 7-foot-tall teenagers. When they get to gym class, they play dodgeball. The 7-foot-tall teenagers turned into giant cannibals and attacked Percy and Tyson. But Tyson didn't even get hurt a little bit. Percy took out his sword Riptide and fought off the cannibals. Annabeth, a girl from Camp Half-Blood, comes to save Percy. Annabeth tells Percy that Tyson is a Cyclops from Poseidon and an Earth Nymph. Annabeth also tells Percy that Thalia's tree that saves the borders of Camp Half-Blood was poisoned by someone inside the camp. When they get to camp, they ask for a quest to get the Golden Fleece to save camp and get Grover. Mr. D says no as always and lets Clarice take the quest. Percy and Annabeth and Tyson go on the quest anyways and embark on many adventures on the way. So get this book at your nearest library and see if they can save Grover and get the Golden Fleece.
Hotel for Dogs. For my book report, I chose the book Hotel for Dogs by Lois Duncan. I chose this book because I love dogs and I wanted an interesting book. This book begins with Andy and Bruce moving because their dad got a temporary job assignment. They had to live with their Aunt Alice temporarily. This is bad news because Aunt Alice is allergic to dogs. Andy is especially upset because she has to leave her dog Bibi behind. Aunt Alice said a boy named Jerry lived across the street. Jerry threw rocks at the back of a brown house in the neighborhood and all the windows were broken. The person who lived in the brown house had his life ruined so badly by Jerry that he moved away. One day after school, Andy was outside and a homeless dog was in Aunt Alice's front lawn. Andy asked her mom if they could keep the stray dog, but her mom said no. When everyone was busy, the homeless dog snuck in. Andy told Bruce they could hide the dog. Andy pretended to stay homesick from school to take care of the stray dog. When Bruce came home from school, they found out that the dog had puppies. Andy decided to name the dog Friday. Where were they going to keep all these dogs? Bruce thought that the old brown house down the street would be a great place. It could be a hotel for dogs. Soon, Andy was taking in more stray dogs than they could handle. Bruce was getting angry because he didn't know how they could feed any more dogs. They could barely feed Friday and her puppies. What were they going to do with all these homeless dogs? How could they keep the dog hotel a secret? I would definitely recommend reading the book Hotel for Dogs to find out what happens next.
Okay, now if you want to see this video again or others like it, you can go to our website, homeworkhotline.org, and then click on videos. All right.
All right.
And Ed, we have an email question you're going to do?
All right.
Okay.
Right. And you're going to read it for me?
I am.
Thank you, Mr.
Z. All right. And the question is to simplify two different fractions. So the first one is 9 over 15.
9 over 15.
All right. And the second one is 10 over 82.
Gotcha. Thanks, Mr. Z.
All right.
10 over 82. All right, good questions. I know a lot of our students in the 4th, 5th, 6th grade are simplifying fractions. Therefore, what we need to find in order to do fraction simplification is we need to find a value that goes into both of these numbers evenly. Again, a lot of this stuff boils down that you know your multiplication facts. Okay, so I'm looking at the numbers 9 and 15, and I can think of a pretty simple number that goes into both of them evenly. The only factors that you can get to go into 9 evenly are 1, 3, and 9. Okay, well, 1 goes into everything, and 9 does not go into the 15 evenly. So that narrows it down to the 3. And I know 3 does go into the 15 because I know my multiplication facts. All right, so 9 divided by 3 gives me 3, and 15 divided by 3 is 5. And I can't simplify it any further. The only number that would go into both 3 and 5 evenly would be 1, and that would change nothing. So 9 15th simplified is 3 fifths. All right, let's do this other one. A little bit tougher here, okay? But I know my even numbers and my odd numbers, and I can see that 10 and 82 end in such a way that I know they're both even numbers, and 2 goes into all even numbers. Numbers that end in 0, 2, 4, 6, and 8 will always be even. So I can start off by dividing them by 2. Now it may go further. I may be able to simplify more. We'll see. All right, 10 divided by 2 is 5.
two goes into two once here, two goes into eight four times. And I get 5/41. I don't think I could simplify that any further. I'm pretty sure 41 and 5 are both prime numbers. So again, the only number that would go into both of them is the number 1, and that does me no good. You can't simplify any further. So 10/82, simplified, is 5/41. And whoever sent that email, thank you very much.
This country is comparable in size to Colorado or Japan, but it only has a population of about 4 million, making it one of the world's least crowded countries. Although this country has gained its independence from Great Britain in 1907, Queen Elizabeth II is still the official head of state. New Zealand is actually a group of islands in the southeastern Pacific Ocean. The closest country to New Zealand is Australia, which is about 1,000 miles away. The islands of New Zealand were formed by volcanic forces pushing land out of the ocean. Today, New Zealand is still home to more than 50 volcanoes, some of which are still active. New Zealand has a spectacular landscape with lush greenery, mountains, and rainforests. Here's a fun fact about New Zealand. Because of the beautiful landscapes, the popular film trilogy, The Lord of the Rings, was filmed entirely in New Zealand.
Well, Mr. Z, we got a winner in your science challenge.
All right, hello.
Hi.
Hi, who's this?
Fred.
Hi, Fred.
Hi, Fred.
Fred, what is this called and what does it do?
It's a swing cyclometer.
You're right.
Wow.
And what can we do with it?
It measures humidity and dew point.
It does. And you know what, Fred? Are you taking your science? Have you already taken it?
I've already taken it.
You've already taken it? Well, tell me what I got to do, because we're going to do it on the air and show people what it does.
You take the thermometer with the wet bulb, and you get it wet.
All right, let me do that right now. You're absolutely right. So I've got a little cotton wick on there and carefully poured some water on the floor. Okay. Now what do I got to do, Fred?
You grab it by the handle and you sling it.
All right, now why is this important? Sling. What's happening here, Fred?
As you sling it, the air cools it.
It does.
And it lowers the temperature.
Right, because that wet bulb, there's evaporation, right?
Yes.
All right. Evaporation is a cooling process. Sometimes people wet their finger and stick in the air to see which way the wind's blowing. Okay, so depending on the amount of moisture in the air, that temperature is going to go down further or further the
drier
the air. You're
getting a good workout here.
Oh, yeah.
With that thing.
All right, so I'm going to ask Ed to read our dry bulb is what?
20?
22?
22?
Yep. And our wet bulb is...
I can't quite see that. Is that also?
Yeah, it's about 20, maybe 19
again.
Or 20. We're going with
not
20.
Not quite as high.
All right, so let me go to the board, Fred. All right, our dry bulb was 22. Okay, our wet bulb was 20. And the wet bulb always has to be lower than or equal to the dry bulb, right?
Mm-hmm. Right.
All right, and what do I want to do with those two numbers?
You go to the table, you go to the dry bulb reading.
Right.
And find your temperature.
All right, which was the 22. Dry bulb was 22, okay.
But and if you find the gold on the top, it'll be the difference, which is 2.
You got it. Okay, so over here, I was going to find the difference. So we find the difference, which is 2, and where those two intersect would be...
That'd
right,
be your temperature.
That would
be your humidity.
That would be my humidity. And it'd be in percent, so I don't know if you can see that very well, but our humidity is 83%. Now, that's indoors here in the studio, right? I could also find the dew point, couldn't I?
Yeah.
And I do that the same way.
Chart, though.
Right, so I moved up to the dew point chart. We still have 22, and our difference was?
2.
It was 2. All right, and our answer there is 19, right? I don't know, it's probably too small for you to see. And that's 19 degrees Celsius, okay? What? Since you're doing such a great job, Fred, what is the dew point? What would that mean if we got down to the dew point?
It'd be when you get condensation, like water droplets on grass.
Okay,
or
good.
Condensation.
Absolutely. So that would be the point at which the air would be saturated. Relative humidity would be 100%, right?
Right.
Right. Okay, great job, Fred. You know, Ed was asking me earlier, what's the difference between relative humidity and dew point? Relative humidity is a measure of how much moisture is in the air compared to how much it could hold at that temperature, right? And there's two things that would affect humidity, the amount of moisture in the air, but also the temperature, right? So if the temperature goes up, what's going to happen to that relative humidity?
It's gonna increase.
It's actually gonna go down. The humidity would decrease, even though there's the same amount of moisture in the air, and that's a good thing because that's what we use in our hair dryers, our clothes dryers. They don't take moisture out of the air. They raise the temperature, which lowers the humidity, right? And so often people would use the dew point as really a better measure of how much moisture is in the air because that doesn't change with the temperature. If there's a certain amount of moisture in the air, the dew point's gonna stay the same unless the amount of moisture changes, right? All right, well, Fred, you did a great job. Are you in chemistry now?
No, I've already gone through that.
Oh, well, you did a great job. Right. I'm glad you remembered your science. You must have had a great teacher. Congratulations. But don't forget, now, every correct response goes in our Hotline Hall of Fame. There are enough points, you can win a tablet at the end of the season.
Now, that's all the time we have for tonight. We are going to say goodbye, but the Hotline teacher is available with free homework help on the phones until 7 tonight.
All right, now, tune in on Monday for our New York State of Mind.
Good night.
Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you. ¶¶